So today is June 23rd, 2021. My name is Kevin Chen. I'm with the Houston Asian American Archive. And today I'll be talking with Miss Alex Chester, who's an actor, activist, writer, and also a producer. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to talk with me today.
Thank you for having me.
So I guess I'll first start off with a few questions about some of your early experiences. I'm kind of curious to learn, like, I guess, when and where you were born.
So I was born in Tustin, California.
And I guess, what was it like in your household as a child?
So I was raised by my mom and grandmother, who are of Jewish American descent. And so I was raised as a Jewish American woman. And I'm third generation on both sides of my family. So my dad's side is Japanese American. And then I'm Russian Jewish on my mom's side. And I didn't have that much contact with my dad growing up, not until a little later in life.
So, you know, having both that, like, Jewish American, Japanese American, like, background, did you have any, I guess, like, you would say unique, like, family or household experiences?
Not really. You know, both sides of my family are very Americanized just because of where we sit generation-wise. So, you know, we try to keep, like, my mom's side, we try to keep the high holidays, but we didn't have enough money to belong to a synagogue. And then as far as my Japanese side, you know, we wouldn't have, like, traditional Japanese food when we were with them. We would maybe go to the Chinese restaurant because it was cheaper. Also, like, my dad's side of the family, since they were interned, I really think that they really tried not to be Japanese, if that makes sense. They really tried to assimilate as best as possible after being basically imprisoned. So my dad didn't speak Japanese. My aunt doesn't speak Japanese. I don't speak Japanese.
So I guess, so like as a child, did you, I guess, ever kind of get interested in the culture aspect, or were you kind of, I guess, like isolated from it because of like your family?
Yeah, I would say I was isolated from it just because there really wasn't too much connections, if that makes sense. Like my dad's side of the family wasn't, other than that they are Japanese, they didn't really have like we didn't celebrate Boys and Girls Day. I don't have a Japanese name. And I feel like that because of the internment, there's just so much trauma there that it was just kind of like, let's not talk about it. We're gonna pretend it didn't happen and we're assimilated, so we're American. So I really didn't, other than, you know, knowing that I looked differently than maybe kids at school or going to auditions and stuff, that would be my only thing of being like, oh, huh, I'm not, you know, fully Japanese, fully Jewish. I'm mixed. So that was more of my experience. I know that, like, for my dad later on in his life before he passed, he did start to get more into the culture, I would say. And like, he definitely instilled in me a love of Japanese food. He could not cook it to save his life. Like, he made Chinese chicken salad in a garbage bag. That was how So he was not a cook, but I would say that because of the time when I was growing up, I was being constantly told by casting and my agents that I neither needed to be present more Asian or I needed to present more white. I never really got to just be. So whatever, and to me at that time, Asian meant, it wasn't like it was considered a monolith, right? And it's still, it's something we're struggling with as well, but especially with casting back then, Asian was just like everything. It wasn't just, they weren't like, try to be more Japanese. It was just specifically be Asian, or can you do an Asian accent? Whatever that means, right? I'm not sure if that really answers your question, but I didn't really, I've never been to Japan. I was supposed to go in 2020, but COVID. So hopefully next year.
Yeah. Great insight. And I guess you mentioned kind of like auditions and, you know, casting. So I'm curious kind of to learn, I guess, how did you, I guess, kind of find the opportunity to like perform at such a young age? Like, were you recruited, or kind of did your family look around for opportunities?
Well, my mom looked around for opportunities. She put me in dance class and voice lessons when I was like four. And my dance studio that I was going to actually gave me my first opportunity to perform on stage. And then, you know, like, I was such a ham as a kid. I'd be that kid that would like stand where all the mannequins are on at the mall display and pretend to model. I just thinking about it, like, it's cringeworthy. And so people will come up to my mom and be like, she should model. And so, you know, it was, my mom picked up Backstage, which was the trade paper at the time and still is. And I forget, there was another one. I don't remember the name of it. And I had an agent, so I was modeling. So it was, my mom would drive me around and I loved it. I really loved it up until I'd say my teen years. And that's when I really realized that I was like, oh, I'm different. This is going to be really hard.
You know, on the topic of that, was, I guess, acting or modeling kind of always like a dream, or did that kind of change as you grew older?
It's definitely changed as I've grown older, but it has always been something that I have enjoyed and loved. I think that as I grew older and it wasn't just like, oh, this is fun. I'm going to the audition and I'm a kid and like, I'm just having fun. And then I started, you know, after a while, when you do start to get rejection, it kind of, you start to realize, oh, huh. And then you start getting the feedback of, well, she's just not Asian enough. We love her, but she doesn't fit the family. Or, you know, maybe dye your hair darker so that, you know, you can be more Asian presenting. Or let's add some highlights and maybe you'll pass more white. So that's, and I would say that was around when I was like 13, around that age. That's kind of when I realized, oh boy, this is going to be really rough. But I was very passionate about being a performer, and it was something that always called to me. I would say it's definitely evolved since I moved to New York City and have met a new group of people, and then just found other passion projects and other things that have really give me a different perspective on life. And just the fact that there wasn't much representation for the mixed API voice. And that's something that I really wanted to create for myself, was to find that community and give that community to people that live in the Midwest that don't necessarily see other people that look like them. So that's, I would say that that is kind of how my, it has all evolved. I hope that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, you mentioned a lot, kind of the whole, like, being Asian, being mixed, especially in the, like, the performing industry, there were some issues, like, back then and, like, even now. So could you kind of touch on, I guess, how that attitude has evolved and how much it has, like, improved throughout the years?
I think it's evolved in the sense that there is more work available. It's still slim, in my opinion. But at the time, you know, growing up, there was like, what, there was Joy Luck Club that came out when I was little, and that was it. And then you had Mulan, the animated series, the animation. Otherwise, it was like every once in a while, there would be an Asian person on TV or film, but they would be playing a stereotype. It wouldn't just be a person, and they would kind of be the butt of the joke. So I think now we are seeing a transition of, oh, that's not cool. We can't do that anymore. And that's because, you know, the younger generation, my generation, were starting to speak up. And not that the older generation wasn't speaking up. It was just that now I think we have social media platforms to help amplify that. It wasn't like there wasn't people trying to have the work done. There just wasn't that amplification of social media and people retweeting and reposting. And now we have that. So I think that's what's really helped improve the visibility of Asian Americans on TV and film. I do think, and I've noticed recently, that a lot of movies and TV shows surrounding maybe the Asian narrative have kind of gone a little bit backwards, in the sense that we have to once again know a martial arts, and we once again have to speak an Asian language. And we're also like somehow maybe a mystical creature, it has superpowers. We just aren't playing people. So I've kind of noticed that the trend is starting to, I kind of backtrack in a way, but at the same time, we have made leaps and bounds. I do think with the Me Too movement, that really helped people, especially within the entertainment industry, say, hey, you can't say these racist things to me or ask me these racist questions or put this in your script. And I think that that also really helped amplify the Asian American voice. There's still, I think, a long, long way to go, because we're still always very much othered. Even like, I know that, I mean, I have people come up to me and I was like, what are you? You're so exotic. And it's like, oh my gosh, I'm American. I've been third generation. And then they're like, oh, well, you don't look that, you know, you don't look Japanese. I've had someone fight with me that they thought I looked Ukrainian. And I'm like, I'm not Ukrainian. Thank you. I'm not. But why are you fighting me on this?
Yeah, it's really like problematic to hear that it's still so rampant, like even today. And also, yeah, go ahead.
It's wild. Even here in New York City, where like, I mean, there's been so much hate crimes happening. And I have to say, I acknowledge my privilege in being mixed, that I don't necessarily have to worry about walking down the street as an Asian American woman, because people don't necessarily know what I am. So I totally acknowledge that I do not have the same, won't have encounter the same problems. I still have to worry about being a woman walking down the street, but not necessarily being involved in a hate crime. But it's just amazing that here in New York City, where there's just so many beautiful colors of people and representation here, that we have that. And I've had people follow me literally screaming, what are you? Hey, I have a bet. What are you?
Yeah, and you know, like given, like you mentioned, like the spike in like anti-Asian sentiment, violence. I guess, do you have any suggestions for how people of like Asian descent, you know, either mixed or not, to kind of dispel the climate?
I think speak up. If you see something, say something. There's a lot of awesome like classes being offered for free within various cities of how to intervene when you see a violence happening in a safe way, like how to intervene safely. I would say take those classes. I would say speak up, that your voice matters. And it really is just a matter of speaking up, not being afraid to say something. I don't think we have to assimilate or be the model majority. You know, I think we can just be human beings and just say, no, that's not cool. And just continue to share our stories, because stories are what connect us to everyone. You know, I really truly believe that if we could all sit down, like just the world could sit down and have some good food together, I think everything would be okay.
So I would kind of like to shift to, I guess, some, your education and kind of your career experiences. So I guess the first question I have is, you know, your early experiences like modeling for children's clothing lines and ads. As a child, what did you kind of think of these endeavors?
I thought it was so much fun. I have always loved fashion. And so getting to try on clothing and take photos, God, I was such a ham. It's so embarrassing. I just loved it so much. So I was actually so sad when I hit 13 and I was told, hey, you're not going to be able to have a career anymore as a model. You're too short. It broke my heart because I just loved it so much. And I can remember, so I did a ton of work for Mattel, like Barbie and all their other little toys. And I was a hand model for a few Barbie doll boxes. And it was so cool getting to go to Mattel and they would show me all the toys that they're designing and I would get to play with them before anyone else. So it was just really fun. I really had a great time with that. It was a really unique experience and I'm really happy to have had that.
And yeah, your experience is also extended into like music as well. Like I learned that you were a part of the girl group Dream. Yes. For a short period of time. So could you kind of tell us a bit about that?
Sure. So when I was, oh gosh, I think 13, same timeline, 13, my vocal coach had found out that this woman, Judy Fontaine, was forming an all group girl group. So I auditioned and I got in along with three other girls. And from that, we became known as First Warning. And then we got picked up by this other producing group called, I think, 2620, I want to say. One of the main producers on that, Vincent, I'm going to forget his last name, which is probably just as well. He was also Lady Gaga's producer, was our producer. Probably one of the most abusive human beings I've ever met. He was our main producer. And then eventually from there, we moved to P. Diddy. And I left just as they joined Puff Daddy. It was not a good experience. It was really not. They put us on very strict diets and we had a very strict exercise regimen. So we had to run 6 miles every day plus other like strength training and classes. And then we would also have like dance rehearsal for 4 to 6 hours. Plus we were in the recording studio that entire time. And it really just messed with, I think, everyone's heads, body image wise. It was really the first time that like I became aware of my body in a negative sense. Yeah, so the producers were very abusive. They didn't feed us, they didn't let us. It was just terrible, very verbally abusive. And then they really tried to play up my Asian-ness. So they would put me in, for the lack of better word, kind of like, oh, I hate it, very stereotypical clothing, right? Which they probably didn't even know the traditional names of the stuff. I didn't at the time. And they forced me to dye my hair black because they wanted me to present more Asian. And they really just wanted to exoticize me. And then, so I got out of it because the producers wanted us to sign as P. Diddy, but they didn't want us to look at the contract. They said our lawyer could not look at it. And so my mom was like, oh, hell no. She's not signing a contract without us letting the lawyer look at it. And so they were like, okay, bye. Which honestly was the best thing ever.
Yeah, I mean, it's great that you got out of that, honestly.
Yeah, I've been kind of in touch with one of the other former members, and she said that she wishes she had gotten out when I had. You know, they really pitted us against each other at the time. Like they wanted the drama between the girls. They wanted that competitive nature. It wasn't like girl power, like uplift women, supporting women. It was very much dog eats dog. And it's been kind of nice now having that closure of reconnecting of a few of the girls and being like, oh, hey, you had a terrible experience. So did I. We both had terrible experiences. They pitted us against each other. Let's be friends now, you know?
Yeah, and so I don't know if the performing industry, music industry is like that now, but would you say that's, I guess, one of the dark sides of the industry that like most people don't know about or like hear about, especially?
I would say so. I would say because they're like, you know, Mongols. They're like they have such power, you know, that once again, until like really the Me Too movement, I don't think that anyone would have listened. I forget which artist it was, but she had brought allegations against her producers for a lot of misconduct, and she brought them to court, and they like tried to silence her very, very terribly. You know, everyone knows I think it's not a secret within the industry that it's dark and that there's a lot of bad things that happen. It's just if you wanna make it, you're gonna do whatever they say you're gonna do. But definitely to an outsider looking in, they just see the glamour, the photo shoots, you know, fancy clothing. They don't see the abuse that happens.
Not to make this depressing, but I guess like on that experience, like, were there any times in your life where you thought like maybe I should do something else, or were you always like gung-ho? This is what I want to do.
I had for a while thought, I mean, I graduated high school 2 years early. So at the time I was like, oh, I don't really want to go to college. I'm already doing what I want to do. Maybe I'll go to culinary school. So I played around with that idea for a while, and I actually recently revisited that idea and nixed it. So I feel pretty good at that decision. But there really wasn't anything at the time that really piqued my interest other than performing. it was always something that really I wanted to do.
And, you know, I learned that you've played in numerous musicals and plays. You're very obviously very passionate about theater. So I guess, when did you discover like theater as a passion?
Well, my first show was when I was 5 years old, and I was the little girl in Gigi at the Grand Dinner Theater. And then I played Molly and Annie. And at one point when I was, I think, 7 and 8, I worked on a cruise ship even doing Meet Me in St. Louis. So I just always loved being on stage as a kid. And even as an adult, I still enjoy it. There's a lot of things I'm aware of now within the industry that make me kind of go, ew. I don't know how I feel about theater anymore. There's a lot that needs to change around, you know, the POC and the BIPOC narrative and all that. I think that needs to really change. It's such a white-centric field. So I and there's just a lot of anxiety surrounding being in those spaces now for myself. And I know for many other actors, I have to say that like having 2020 to kind of not have to hustle as hard for the auditions and just kind of sit and be was really a wonderful thing. It really gave me time to reflect about what my values are and what I will and will not do.
You know, on the topic of theater, like maybe could you take me through the preparation for playing a role, like in a play, and perhaps you could do it in the context of like a play you were recently part of.
Sure. So I guess the most recent role, like a book play that people would be familiar with is the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. So I got to play Logan Schwartz and Grubinier, who was usually played by a usually white person. So I think I try to do a lot of research and find out, but I'm pretty sure I'm the first Asian American to play this role. So that was really cool. And I love this part. So for me, what went into that was coaching with my voice teacher on the music, making sure that everything had sat within my voice in a comfortable way and that I wasn't pushing. And I learned the music that way. And also I would watch like bootleg copies of different versions of the show, just to get an idea of the overall character other than what is on the book, just to see what other people brought to the table. And then from there, I just put myself into it a lot. Like I really related to this character. She is a go-getter and she has high anxiety. So I was just like, hey, I get to play myself for a change. I can just be an anxious mess on stage and it's perfect. So, yeah, and it was just a lot of, you know, for me, memorization comes pretty easily. I knock on wood, I've been always very gifted with that. So I like being memorized usually before I go into a rehearsal room, if I can, or at least be very comfortable with the material. So that way I'm not scrambling. So I usually try to be very prepared just so that I can then actually enjoy the process and I'm not stressing too much. And also it just depends on how long of rehearsal process you have and what the timeline is. Sometimes like, for instance, when I did Into the Woods, I knew I booked the part like months ahead of time. And I knew we only were gonna have like 5 days of rehearsal to put Into the Woods on its feet. And that is an extremely technically difficult show to sing. So I made sure that like I learned all my music as best as I could prior to coming into the rehearsal room, just because I knew there wouldn't be enough time to actually, hey, can you go over that again? Can you do that again? Can you pound out my harmony there? So I just really try to be as prepared as possible with that.
Sounds like very intense. Would you say, especially during like rehearsal, there's a lot of like after hours work, like you're working
constantly. I mean, another thing I recently joined is the Randy Andes. It's a singing group inspired by the Andrew Sisters. So I was given 16 songs of harmony to learn and only 9 hours of in-person rehearsal with the girls, which is nothing. And that's including like dancing. I had to like watch the videos that they had recorded and learn the dance moves from the recordings. So for me, I was, you know, I'm navigating all the Zoom meetings I'm doing for my magazine and festival, and then, you know, auditions that I have to self-tape for, and then trying to learn all this music. So I was probably going until after midnight a lot of times. I was like, okay, my cutoff is at midnight. I just gotta get this down. And that's what I was doing leading up until the first show.
Wow.
So yeah, there's a lot of, you know, they you get this, you get paid, but if you actually break down how much time and effort that you put into the projects, it's like pennies that you're getting paid per hour.
Blood, sweat, and tears, right?
Wow. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You really, anyone who goes into this industry thinking that they're doing it for money or the fame is going to be very surprised. And granted, there are instances where like someone's first audition for a movie and then suddenly they're a starlet. Like that does happen, but it's very rare.
Yeah. And you know, I looked at kind of your like resume on your website, and you're skilled in things like fencing, ballet, like tap dancing, just to name a few, actually. I guess what motivated you to pursue like training in these areas, and is it mostly like to help your career, I guess?
Yeah. So if you're going to be in musical theater, you have to have a background in ballet, tap, and jazz, and musical theater. I have a very small background in hip hop. It's I'm not good at it. So it's just, and I'm not really good at ballet either, but you have to at least have the basics, especially if you want to pursue theater. You just do musical theater. Fencing was really for me. I always have enjoyed watching the sport. So I really got into it when I was 17 until I was like 20. They wanted me to join the team, be on the women's team, and like start competing competitively. And I was like, no. My life is already competitive enough of auditions. I just want to stab people. I just want to have some fun. I'm actually looking at starting to learn. It's so funny when I just said, oh, things are going kind of backwards where Asian Americans have to know martial arts. Well, I've always been very interested in learning like how to sword fight, like with a katana. So I'm actually going to start taking lessons in that coming up. And that's just something I've always been interested in. I haven't had the time. And now that I'm out of school, I was like, well, why not? Why not pursue that? So I would say for training, yeah, you definitely, if you're going to be in musical theater, you have to have the basics, tap, jazz, and ballet under your belt. And any other skill sets is even better. If you do gymnastics, wonderful. Though I can honestly say no one really wants to be tumbling 8 shows a week. I have many friends who were like, oh, like booked a show because they tumble. And then they were like, I should have never raised my hand when they asked if anyone tumbled. Oh, this is killing my body.
Yeah. Like speaking of school, I saw that you recently graduated with a bachelor's in theater.
Bachelor's in dance.
Oh, okay. Okay. Sorry. So I guess what pushed you to obtain this degree in recent years, or like why now?
I was so close to graduating. I literally had 10 units, like I was shy of 10 units that I thought, why not? I should just go back to school and finish getting my degree. I had been at Cal State Long Beach previously, and I was doing the Broadway production, sit down Broadway tour of How the Grinch Stole Christmas at the Pantages Theater. And I saw that some of my fellow students were doing like the Halloween horror nights at the Queen Mary, and they were getting credit for like school credit for their performance as a monster. So I had asked, hey, I'm in this, you know, basically a Broadway show. Can I get credit? And they're like, no, there's no way we can grade you on this. And that was really frustrating. And then I was told I would have to take beginning movement for actors at the school. Meanwhile, I've had this entire career as a performer and beginning voice as well. And I try to contest, and I was like, hey, can I test out of this? You can see my resume. I'm happy to present something to you. No, you have to take this. Don't you want a college experience? And I was like, no, I really just want my degree. So one of my professors, Craig Fleming, like, well, this man, he was an Imagineer at Disney for many years, really encouraged me to, he's like, you don't need this. He's like, if I were you, I would find a different avenue to pursue your degree. So that's when I left Cal State Long Beach and I heard about LEAP, which is an accelerated program specifically for dancers and performers through the St. Mary's College in Northern California. And so I joined that. And then I was doing that for a few years, like about a year, 2 years. And then I moved to New York City and I went, oh my God, there's no way I can do school and try to actually really pursue being a performer. It was just too much. It was too overwhelming for me at the time. So now, and now like I really felt, I feel very rooted. I feel really grounded. So I guess like a year and a half ago, I was like, you know, why not? Maybe I'll go back to school. I only have 10 units. Let's just get it done. It's why not? And I did. And I'm really happy. I'm the first student of the LEAP program to win the Dean's Award for Academic Excellence and Community Engagement from St. Mary's. And I've been told it's a big deal. I was like, oh, cool. I got this placard.
Congratulations. Yeah.
Thank you. And, you know, I made the Dean's List and honor student and like totally overachieving, but it wasn't intentional. I wasn't trying to win any accolades. I just, yeah, they were really supportive of combining the work I do with my magazine and my studies. So I would have like independent study time. So for my senior project, for example, I created a marketing plan specifically for my magazine, and that counted towards my senior project. And then for my last project, I created another marketing plan for the festival that my company is throwing. And it was kind of nice because I was killing two birds with one stone.
So yeah, I want to talk a bit about your your magazine, but before that, I have just a quick question about roles in acting and choosing them. Have you ever turned down a role because you thought it misrepresented Asians or Asian Americans?
I've turned down an audition for sure. Usually I won't get to that point where I book a show. Like I will read the script for the audition and then decide. So recently there was a video game voiceover job. And it was very like, she's a big breasted Asian exotic woman. And I was reading this description and then this monologue she had to say about having a threesome. And I just went, no, I am not auditioning. So I emailed my agent and said, hey, I'm really uncomfortable with this. I know this video game company. I can't say what it is just because, but if you would, they're well known for like, you kill prostitutes in our video game, stuff like that. And I just went, I said, unless, I said, I'm sorry, I can't do this. This is just really uncomfortable for me. And then my agent called me and he's like, I'm so sorry I submitted you for this. I didn't even really look at the breakdown. I was just like, oh, 20s, sure. Asian American, I'll submit her. And he's like, I am so sorry. Please let me know if that ever comes up again. There's been a couple of other auditions where they wanted, you know, kind of like fresh off the boat, Asian accent. And I'll just be like, you know, hey, I'm not comfortable with this. Sorry, I'm not going to audition. And my agents have been very respectful of that. And a lot of times, you know, yes, I'm an actor, but sometimes it's very, especially because I am mixed, I am third generation American, it just feels disingenuous to me. So I've gotten better about saying no. You know, granted back when I was younger, you really just couldn't say no. If you did, agents didn't understand, casting didn't understand, and you had to go with it. But things have changed, luckily. Sadly, though, there's still these stereotypical roles out there that you do have to go, oh, am I really gonna audition for this? I even had my agent, there was an audition for a nail technician And I was like, he's like, do you really want to audition for this? You don't have to do this. And I said, hey, does she have to have an accent? Does it say anything around that? No, she doesn't. I went, well, I'm going to audition and I'll bring just myself to the table and we'll see, you know, didn't get it. But because I knew what they wanted, but I wasn't going to do it. And I kind of went just to be like, hey, I'm not going to do what you want.
And, you know, actually, were there any times, I guess, in your early career or even now where you face like outright discrimination due to like your ethnicity or race?
I mean, they're not supposed to ask you what you are in the room. It's illegal. Like, it's actually illegal. But I've been asked in the room of an audition, the casting has asked me, what are you? And they can't ask you that. So that I feel that's very discrimination. They're not asking a white person walking through them what they are. So I would say that, or, you know, can you Asian it up more? Can you give us a little Asian accent? And you're like, what does that mean? What does Asian accent mean? And I know what it means. We all know what it means. It means, you know, like, make your R's L's and the L's R's. And they wanted something just so stereotypical that it means nothing. And I've had that in the room many times. It's luckily now they don't do that, but I would say like 5 years ago they still were doing that.
So moving on now to I guess your community involvements and like activism, I'm curious to learn how you came to be like the creator and editor-in-chief of, you know, Mixed Asian Media.
Sure. So I started off writing a blog when I moved to the city called Miso Hapa. I wanted to play on the words and kind of take back the power of, you know, the stereotypical phrase miso horny. So I was kind of playing on that and just being like, you know, I'm going to take this power back. And, you know, I, of course, now that there's a lot of that has changed involved around the word Hapa, but we can get into that in a little bit. And it just kind of became too much for me to run by myself. So I was fortunate enough to meet a ton of mixed API actors in New York. And I was like, hey, you know, it'd be really cool because there's nothing else out there like it. What if we started our own magazine? And it could just be a lifestyle magazine. We can cover basically whatever we want. We can interview people and it'll just be something fun. And so that's how Hapa Mag came about. We have since rebranded to Mixed Asian Media in part because of there has been, what's the words? The word Hapa it's kind of loaded. And the word Hapa came about because of the colonization of Hawaii, right? Yes, it is a way that many mixed Asians do identify, but a lot of people don't necessarily know the origins of the word and the history of the word. So out of respect to our indigenous native Hawaiians, we have decided to change the word, not use that word within our magazine. I believe you can identify any way you would like, as long as you're being respectful. I think Hapa has been a way to unify the mixed API community. And I personally think it's better than being called Hafi. I don't like being called Hafi. And I don't identify as Hafu because I am not Japanese. And yeah, so Mixed Asian Media then came about because we wanted to be respectful of the word Hapa and make sure that we weren't, you know, stealing a word to speak. You know what I mean? We wanted to make sure we're very respectful of that. And also our brand has grown so much. We have a festival now. We don't want to just be a digital online magazine. We want to be a media platform that has podcasts, that has, you know, video content, that can be so much more. So that was also part of the reason to rename to Mixed Asian Media.
Could you kind of go a bit more into detail about some of the content you guys post? I know you said it was mostly like whatever, but.
It's definitely, if you go onto our website now and you look back at our first issue, it's like, whoa. They were newbies at this. We definitely have our skill set has evolved and I think we've definitely gotten better, thankfully. So, you know, first we started off with like, luckily, being in the entertainment industry, I do have connections to like more well-known actors and so was able to at least get for the first issue, a couple of up and coming mixed APIs to interview. And then we would just have, you know, like what color lipstick looks best on mixed Asian, stuff like that. Fun stuff, you know, skincare for mixed Asian because it is different. And my esthetician is mixed Chinese, so she has a lot to say on that. So she was writing articles for us. It has since evolved now to the point where PR companies reach out to us. We're not like begging them for interviews. They're asking us, hey, I have this person and this person. Can you interview them? Are you sure you can't interview them? We really would want you to interview them. And we have to say no sometimes, which is kind of cool. So it has evolved from like us sending out these emails, being like, hi, we would really love to interview so and so. You know, we're beginning out. And now we can be like, hey, we've interviewed Jessica Henwick, we've interviewed Apollo Ono, you know, Jason Tobin. And just Japanese breakfast, we would like to interview your person. And they're usually like, oh yeah, wow, cool. Yes, we wanna, please. We're also, you know, gotten into the point where production companies or major groups like Netflix and Disney are giving us money to set up photo shoots with their clients. And that's been really cool. It's been a really awesome, surprising thing that's happened in very recently. So now we're able to do that. We'll be flying out soon to LA for a photo shoot, which I would never have thought would be possible. Yeah, and I had to turn down and I think it was Jason, was it Jason Tobin? I had to turn down an interview recently with someone, and I felt bad, but we had just had him in our recent like 2 issues ago, and this one was only going to be a 10-minute interview, and I was like, I'm sorry, unless you can give us like a photo shoot with him or something to go alongside it. It's really not worth our time and energy. So we're trying to be a little better and be a little pickier. Work smarter, not harder, is what we're trying to do. Easier said than done. We did set up a paywall, which we are now taking back because we had thought that it would be a good way to help pay for the expenses because we are all volunteer organization. No one gets paid. I pay for everything out of my pocket, website, taxes, studio rentals. So we had thought that, okay, well, maybe we could set up a paywall and that would be a way to get some income in to help maybe start paying our writers because everyone works so hard. But that sadly kind of, it didn't backfire. We had to try it out. We were being encouraged by many, many prominent people in our lives that you guys need to have a paywall. You guys need to have a paywall. But we tried it. The numbers don't lie. So we're removing the paywall and there's other ways we can monetize. And we're gonna go with that instead. Yeah.
It's good to hear that, you know, magazine's getting so much like good feedback, good exposure as well.
You know, it started with we were mentioned in the 2020 Nielsen Consumer Report on Asian Americans. We were one of three online magazines listed, and that's really what kind of like blew us up. And we've been mentioned in like a BuzzFeed article. There's a couple other articles we've been mentioned in as well. So it's kind of like, whoa, we're actually, you know, I want us to be the number one leading platform for mixed APIs, and knock on wood, so far we are.
And so, would you say that the magazine's mostly targeted towards like mixed Asians or like kind of that crowd, assuming?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, everyone is welcome to read our articles. And I think a lot of people can relate to our stories. You know, at some point or another, every person has had a moment of like identity crisis. I don't care if you're full or whatever, you have those moments. So I think our stories definitely resonate. And I definitely believe that we mixed people bridge cultures and creeds and just basically everything. It's kind of our superpower. And it's a good way to connect people and unite people. So I think that yes, we are geared towards the mixed API experience, but I think that yes, everyone will find something that they connect with if they read our articles and interviews with different people.
And you kind of touched upon this, but do you have like a future vision for mixed Asian media?
You know, I have a couple different scenarios in my mind, like we keep going on the trajectory that we're going and just get more numbers. And then, you know, investors will want to invest in us. Advertisers will want to like show their products on our page, and that will be a way for us to get revenue. Or another option I'm not opposed to is possibly being bought out by another bigger company, but I would still love to maintain, you know, the control of the creative side. And that's always, you know, kind of like sticky. I'm open to it. So I would not be opposed if like Vice is like, hey, we want to bring you guys on. But there would have to be like, I have a lot of kind of rules and stuff. Like I'd want everyone to keep their place, and I'd want them, everyone to get paid and be under, you know, there's a lot of moving parts, but that's kind of what I would hope. And I guess I just hope that I would love for this to become my full-time job, but I would love for it to like money-wise be my full-time job.
Gotcha. And you know, as like an activist, like in the community, was there any like circumstance or like specific period of time in your life where you're like, okay, like I need to take a stand or I need to do something?
Gosh, it's so interesting to be called an activist, because I don't really think of myself that way. There are so many other people like out there in the trenches, pounding the pavement, really doing the hard brunt, sweaty work. And I just try to amplify my community's voices on social media and online. I would say for me, I mean, I guess I believe that making your presence known is a form of activism. And I always would say to my fellow Asian actors and BIPOC actors, show up to the audition. Just show up. I don't care that it says they're only seeking white people. Show up. That in itself is a form of like protest, form of activism, saying we are here and we're going to be seen. I think that's kind of how it started for me. But there are so many other people that really are doing the hard work. And I just hope that my platform can help amplify their voices.
And, you know, I also learned that you are part of the We're Not All Ninjas podcast, which provides like commentary on, you know, Hollywood movies that star or involve like Asian American actors or actors of Asian descent. So I guess like kind of tell me a bit about like
Melissa Slaughter and Rachel Liu. Melissa Slaughter is the main producer, and then Rachel Liu and I were also co-hosts on it. And Melissa had this idea because she was like, hey, there's no podcast out there talking about Asian American representation in film, TV, the arts. There just isn't. And she was right. At the time when we started, there wasn't anything. So that's why we started it, because there was nothing talking about it. We decided we were going to dissect like Joy Luck Club, Mulan. We wanted to do the Aloha, that film with, what's her name? Oh gosh, what's her name? That's terrible. Who was like, I'm part Chinese. Just kidding. I'm not. I'm just a white girl. She just played Cruella in Cruella. God bless. I can't remember her name. Anyways, so we didn't cover that. We were going to, but we both were like, oh God, I don't think I can sit through this and then dissect this film. So we just really, I don't know. I hope that like us calling attention to, you know, Ghosted in the Shell and really talking about how this was Asian erasure. It wasn't just yellow face. It was complete Asian erasure. That kind of helped spearhead maybe this movement to make Hollywood less white and make yellow face not okay. And that's really what the podcast was for, was to just start amplifying our voices and start talking about our stories and be like, hey, Memoirs of a Geisha, this was really kind of a shitty movie. You know, let's talk about it from a male-centric point of view. These women that were, yeah. So I think we just brought a whole nother level that wasn't there in the podcast world at the time. We have since stopped, which is fine. I think we might eventually do like just a final episode of like, hey, thank you for listening for all these years. But we've all become so busy. Rachel has like blown up as this major producer, and Melissa now is working for this major podcasting company. So we just don't have the time.
Are there any other like community involvements that, I guess, you'd like to talk about or share?
As far as different organizations that I work with, or
Yeah, anything, I guess, that you're involved with, or you would just like to talk about organizations, projects, anything like that.
so I would say, like, we've been really fortunate that we have this amazing fiscal sponsor for the festival, Leviathan Lab, which is a BIPOC-run theater company. And they're our fiscal sponsor, and they're a wonderful organization led by Ariel Estrada. And he's just been such an amazing, supportive human being for basically any endeavor and project that I have done, from when I was producing cabarets in New York City to now the magazine to now the festival. He's always just had my back. And same with National Asian Artist Project. They've done a lot with the Asian American community and the children, like kids. They have an amazing program for kids, and Bayer Lee, who is just, she's paved the path for so many of us in the theater arts community. She's quite the living legend. Her organization's wonderful. You know, there's Ma Yi Theater Company, there's NatCo. I mean, there's East West Players is another amazing organization that I grew up doing theater with. This new organization called Strong Asian Lead, run by my friend David, is wonderful, and I highly recommend it. He's one of our sponsors for the festival as well. Yeah, there's just a lot of amazing groups out there that are doing really great work, and then the mixed space is also a really cool project as well. Asian Jews Lunar, the Asian Jewish Project, is also another cool organization. It's just really awesome to see all these groups that are having their voices, like, heard and amplified. I think it's so important to show that being Asian doesn't mean XYZ. It means you can come in all these different shapes, sizes, and colors, you know? And I think it's really cool that these organizations are out there helping amplify that.
I would like to shift a bit to more of your family and personal life. At this point, it seems that like many of us can see the light at like the end of the tunnel with regards to the pandemic. So when the pandemic was at its worst, like a lot of people, were struggling. So I don't know if you did anything to like cope with the pandemic, especially like during lockdown.
So the beginning part of the pandemic was really hard. My dad was dying of cancer at the time, and his oncologist and his doctors were like, "You can't." I wanted to fly back for him. They were like, "You can't fly back because you can't see him. We don't know the contagion." There wasn't testing happening at the time, really, unless you were like full blown had COVID. So I wasn't able to get back to my dad before he passed. So that was really hard. Yeah, literally said goodbye to him the day before he passed by FaceTime, and he could barely hold the phone. He was at the hospital by himself. They wouldn't let any family members in because it was smack in the, like, when the pandemic was at its worst. So my mom couldn't be with him, his sister couldn't be with him, his mom couldn't be with him, and I couldn't. We couldn't even have a funeral. We had a Zoom funeral. We still haven't really had a funeral. It's weird. So that was really hard. I didn't see my mom and grandma for over a year and a half, which was really hard. Yeah, it was really a dark time. I lost out on jobs. Thank God that, the unemployment benefits kicked in, which also then brought to light how backwards our economy is and how backwards the system is. If many of us are, as artists, are making, and not just artists, just human beings, are making more money from unemployment and having a more of a livable wage now than we have ever had before. And I think that is something that's really been brought to light as well. But it was hard. It was very hard. If it wasn't for having school and having, like, deadlines of, like, okay, you gotta get this essay done, you gotta get this reading done. I thrive with structure. I love structure. Having my magazine, and our weekly meetings with my team, that really helped get me through the pandemic. It was scary here. I mean, I'm sure you saw on the news how terrifying New York City was. So it was not a good time.
I'm so sorry to hear about your father. And you know, with the pandemic, there's brought to light a lot of issues, like you said. And yeah, like, I'm just glad we're past it now.
And hopefully it stays that way, you know? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Delta variant. I mean, if we look at India, what's happening there, I'm just like, guys, how, I don't understand how communities and people can say that, like, COVID doesn't kill. It looks like the apocalypse in India. And it looked like it here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, yeah. So I'm trying to be optimistic, but I'm also, I guess, as my therapist says, I'm a realist. So I don't know. I'm not ready to be like, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. I'm not quite ready for that yet.
Absolutely. You know, like, on a more positive note, I guess, your website mentions that you're a crazy cat lady. So, can you tell me a bit about your cats and, I guess, the influence they've had on your life?
So I have my cat, Mogget. He's literally on the floor right here, fast asleep. He's a little black cat. I found him on the streets of New York City. He literally walked up to me, flopped over, and I was like, I guess I have a kitty now. But I didn't grow up with animals just because, you know, I was running around so much with my family to auditions and doing shows. It would have been ridiculous to have a pet and not fair to the pet. So I did get a cat back home, which is really more my family's cat now. His name is Moogle. He's a terror. He just screams all day long at my grandmother, like bosses her around. Like, he wants the bedroom to himself. So he will scream at her until she leaves her room. He's terrible. This cat is, he can be a cuddle bug and he can also be a terror. He'll bite you. He's my little feral kitty, but he's a love bug. So I say I'm a crazy cat lady just because, like, I can spend hours on Instagram just looking at cat videos and be very happy with that. Like, my husband and I will watch videos of cats all day. No shame.
You are also sharing a recipe with us, your Jewish grandmother's beef and cabbage recipe.
Yeah.
So maybe tell us a bit about, like, why it's so special and kind of its importance to you.
Well, this recipe was brought from Romania to Paris and then to the States. So it's been in my family for generations. And it's special to me because my grandmother would only make it, like, for fancy special occasions, even though really this recipe is like peasant food. I mean, it's marrow bones and beef and cabbage and rice. Like, how basic can you really get, right? But she would only make it for special occasions. So that's why it's just like, ooh, my grandma's making this recipe. It's like, it's fancy dinner time, even though, like, it's not at all. It's peasant food. So that's the fact that she even finally gave me the recipe was like pulling teeth to make that happen, and trying to get her to write down like exact measurements. That's not a thing. That's just not a thing. It's like, you just put some of this and you put some of this and it has to taste this way. And it's like, okay, I think I can do that. Otherwise, like, I don't really have any recipes on my dad's side. Like I said, he would make Chinese chicken salad in a garbage bag. And no one wants that. I remember one time he made it in one of those garbage bags that, like, had like some sort of chemical in it, you know, like, and we were like, we can't eat this. This will literally poison us all. Yeah.
Well, you know, the beauty about like family recipes is just like how it's not like, there's no like straight like formula to it. Right, like, it's just passed down, just do it, and, you know, comes out, that's the product.
Yeah, I think, you know, it will never taste exactly like how my grandma's does, but I can get it pretty close, which is good. I've had a lot of practice. That's something I really love to do is cook my grandmother's food recipe, especially because they live so far away from me.
And, you know, I like to talk a bit about your identity, like, growing up. So I know that you mentioned that you're kind of isolated from like the Jewish and Japanese cultures. But, you know, as a child, did you ever feel that you were different, I guess, like, in a sense? And Did you ever want to fit in, or did that even like matter to you?
It's weird because like I grew up in a very predominantly white school. So yeah, we did. Yeah, I don't, there wasn't, I think there was maybe like two other Asian kids in class with me. That's it. I was the only Jewish kid. So I experienced a lot of anti-Semitism for being Jewish. Didn't, kind of got made fun of for like when I would have matzah or a rice ball for lunch, stuff like that. My mom makes good Japanese rice balls, ironically. So they would, you know, make fun of you that way. I didn't ever try to fit in because I just kind of was like, well, is this me? I was always told growing up I was an old soul, so I kind of just ran with it. I'm not sure if that's necessarily true, but I had a hard time relating to kids my age. I had a really hard time connecting with them. I could connect with kids in show business a little bit, depending on the kid. There were some brats, but it was just, I always felt more at home like around adults than I did children. So when I was in 7th grade, I became homeschooled just because the teachers at that junior high were refusing to give me my schoolwork when I was on set. Yeah, which is, I think, illegal. And my mom was just like, "How would you feel about going being homeschooled?" And I was like, "Yes, please." I was getting really bullied at school just because I was kind of different. So I never dressed like a normal kid. Like I was very edgy always, and maybe fashion forward, I should say. And I got made fun of that for that a lot. So I just didn't ever fit in, no matter what. So I was homeschooled from 7th grade on.
And, you know, being homeschooled, you know, like there's like in psychology, I know that, you know, a lot of your values or your beliefs are formed like from your peers, like as an adolescent and beyond. So I'm just curious to hear, like, how do you think like being homeschooled kind of affected your like values and or like cultural values or just values in general?
I honestly think it kind of sheltered me from the negativity and the peer pressures of like high school and, you know, and the racism that a lot of kids did experience in the bullying. I think it sheltered me from that. I think, you know, I grew up in the theater, so I was surrounded by the LGBTQ plus community, and I saw nothing wrong with it. So I can remember being in junior high and even elementary school, and kids would already have these opinions of the LGBTQ plus community that were so negative. And I was constantly fighting them about that because I had my gay uncles, you know, it was just normal to me. It wasn't like, oh, this is like weird and bizarre. No, that was just life. It was just normal. And so I think in a lot of ways, because I was homeschooled, I came out way more accepting of what most people did not at the time. So I actually think I was fortunate, but that's also because, you know, my mom and grandma are incredibly liberal. So I think it would be a different story if I was raised in a Christian homeschool situation, right? It'd be a whole nother story with that. But because I was surrounded by so many beautiful, unique human beings from theater and just my mom and grandma's influence, I think it allowed me to come at the world from a different place and be more accepting. And just not even, it doesn't, it's not even a thing of accepting. It just was. That was just life. That's just people. It wasn't like, oh my God, you're gay. It was like, okay. And
So, you know, I guess like when it comes to identity, it's kind of like complicated, right? It takes years for people to develop or kind of find their identity. So I guess what would you identify yourself as in terms of like race? Would you say you're like Asian American, or do these like categories even like really matter to you at all?
they matter because it's what casting has put me as in a box, you know. It's these, sadly, a lot of my identity has been around the casting arena, you know, what it means to be an actor. And I've actually had to really figure out for me what I identify as. And for me personally, I think I identify as a Jewish mixed Asian woman. I do like to say the word Hapa. I just think it's a beautiful unifying word, but I say that with the utmost respect possible for that word. And it's not something I use lightly at all. But I don't like Hafu. I don't like Hafi, because I'm a whole person. But I think it's taken me, therapy has helped a lot with figuring out my identity. I would say I struggled most with not necessarily my mixed identity, but my identity outside of show business and what does it mean just to be Alex as a human being. Because for so long, I've been in the industry for so long that really was my only identity.
Yeah. A lot of people struggle with identity and also just in general, like feelings like within, like mental health. And, there's like a big like negative like stigma towards that, which is, problematic.
It is. I'm pretty vocal about, everyone should be in therapy. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. And I encourage anyone that is struggling to seek a therapist, because where else can you just talk your face off and not have anyone judge you? It's really liberating once you accept that. But not all therapists are equal, and a lot of times it's expensive and insurance doesn't cover it. So I do realize there is a lot of other factors that go into it.
I have a question about kind of bridging together cultures. So you mentioned you worked with like all kinds of business, all kinds of people, since you're in like the performing acting industry. Do you have any advice for, I guess, bridging together cultures or people with different backgrounds or beliefs or ideas?
I think that shut up and listen is really powerful. That if you come across something you don't know, don't understand, you can ask questions, but then shut up and listen and take in what the other culture or people have to say, and really listen, not just superficially. There's nothing wrong of asking questions. I think that's the only way that people learn, the only way you're going to grow. And I think that's really my big advice. It's just, sometimes you're going to find yourself in a certain space and it's not your place to talk. And just learning that is very powerful. And just knowing when to, like, you know what, this, I'm in a new environment. I'm not necessarily, it's not my turn to speak, and I'm just going to be quiet and let other people talk to me for a change and tell me their stories, and we'll go from there.
So I have like one last question, and it's about, maintaining relevance in the performing industry, especially, during like the pandemic, right? The performing industry was hit like especially hard. So like, how do you do it? Like, how do you maintain, having a job basically?
Well, you don't. There really wasn't any paying jobs to be had. I mean, I was fortunate enough that I did book a TV show, which airs tomorrow. Hopefully I'm not on the cutting room floor. But otherwise, like, there was no work there. I'm fortunate enough to also be part of Model Majority, which is the first all Asian American sketch comedy troupe in New York City. So we had virtual sketch performances, and yeah, we don't get paid, but it was a way to at least have a creative outlet and still stay relevant within the industry. So we would do those performances. One of my best friends, her musical was picked up by the Women's Theater Festival, and it was all recorded by Zoom, and we created musical videos together. Like, she and I would get tested. We were like in our little pod together, and we would make musical videos together for the Zoom, and that was created. So fortunate enough, like, I had other creative outlets besides the magazine, but there was no work to be had. I mean, we all lost out on a lot. And, and also it was okay, like, if you didn't want to be constantly, hey, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here, because sometimes it's sometimes nice just to sit too.
So at this point, I would just like to ask, is there anything else that you would like to share with the archive?
I don't think so. I feel like this is so thorough, and the questions were very good. So I don't really necessarily have anything else I could share. I just appreciate you guys taking the time to speak with me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is one last question. I don't know if you... like if you plan to have kids or not, but I guess they're usually like I ask, like, is there a message you would like to provide this to your descendants? Or if not, just like a general message.
That's so funny. I'm actually hoping to freeze my eggs. It's going to be a process. So we'll see. Actually just, yeah, it's actually very funny. I just hope that there's so much more now that we're aware of, I feel like, this generation and the future generations. And there's so much vocabulary surrounding whether it's the power of saying no, whether it's feeling uncomfortable. And I feel like because of that, that hopefully if I have a child, that they will grow up in a very empowered environment and feel empowered that they have a voice and that they can feel seen. Because if I have a kid, the kid's going to be a quarter Chinese, a quarter Japanese, and half Jewish. And what they'll also be mixed Asian. So I'm just hoping that maybe with the work I've done within the mixed community, that they won't struggle with their identity as I have, and they'll just be free just to be a human being without having to explain themselves.
Thank you so much for sharing that message and for providing your oral history with us today.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me.